Welcome back, AP. Welcome back. Happy Mardi Gras, right? Got my nice little like football that I caught at a parade yesterday. Now, we're going to dive straight head first into this stuff. And just to give you a heads up, this is, count it, the only flip you have to do over break. I decided to go from 2 to 1 and just make one long one and call it a day. And you can like break this thing up a little bit if you want to, make it a little bit easier on yourself. But we are going to pick up right where we left off in class, right? We started kind of shifting gears and we moved into late 19th century France, right? We started talking about Napoleon III. We started talking about him being a politician that's trying to appeal to everybody. He's going to try and actually use the revolutions of 1848 to be his catalyst. He's going to come to become the president of France, mostly due to name recognition and clout and things like that, right? So he's going to try to appeal to a conservative legislative branch whenever that is created as well underneath him. This guy leading it named Adolf Thiers, like, gave him a lot of problems early on. But what's going to go ahead and happen is he's going to appeal to those conservatives by putting the Catholic Church more in charge of education and also restricting some voting rights as well and limiting universal suffrage in France, which is something that we would look at him as being very unprogressive and kind of stodgy and a little annoying, right? So now, but going forward, though, understanding why he did this because he wanted to extend his presidency past a 2-year term, right? And when the assembly didn't rewrite the Constitution to give him a second term, what's he do? He overthrows the government in a military coup, right? He has a coup d'etat in the military government. Does that sound familiar? Yeah, it sounds a lot like his uncle, right? So now, and in 1852, with some middle-class rebels and protests, he re-grants universal suffrage to have what's known as a referendum, right? And his referendum elected him president by 92% for 10 years. And then a year later, in the plebiscite of 1852, they actually elect him by 97% to call him the emperor, right? And they recreate this thing known as the French Second Empire, right? Both of them led by Napoleon. It's a very, very important little fact. Now, the thing about it is, though, is under the French Second Empire, there are going to be mixed successes and mixed failures, right? Now, given the heads up going into it, 1852, you got to look at the French Second Empire in like two distinctive chunks, right? Like, you look at it as pre-1860, post-1860, right? Reason being, it's because there's going to be some cataclysmic things that happen in Europe leading up to 1860, one of them being the Crimean War, right? Just keep that word in the back of your mind, the Crimean War, which is going to be this war that is most basically between Russia and the rest of Europe, right? But the biggest thing about it is from 1852 up till 1860, it was a pretty successful empire. Like, he did well for himself. He had a really, really flourishing economy. And the other big thing about it is he's going to build railroads all over France. That's going to bring industrialism onto the continent. He's going to be responsible for corporate banks issuing those limited liability loans and things like that. He's going to hire housemen to redesign Paris and reinvigorate it in grand style and make it beautiful and gorgeous and really over the top, right? The Arc de Triomphe is going to be a part of the Champs-Élysées and also the... Wait, yeah, the Champs-Élysées, yeah, like, so, like, and it's also going to reinvigorate the entirety of France and really give it that empire-like feel, right? Going into it, though, also, he is going to address unemployment, right? Because declining wages are going to rise along with inflation, right? So, like, oh, wait, excuse me, what am I talking about? That is a sentence that makes no sense. Unemployment declined in the first half of the French Second Empire because he used Haussmann's reform plans and Haussmann's reinvigoration of Paris plans to hire those people. Unemployment goes down, wages rise along with inflation. It's a really good positive times. And how does he pacify the urban worker? He allows them to strike and he allows them to form unions, right? So he's hailed as being a very positive influence throughout this period. But then around 1860, things began to change, right? Mostly due to the fact of all the crazy stuff that's happening in the continent with Italy and Prussia, right? So they begin to denounce this nationalistic Napoleon, liberals and conservatives alike, due to the fact of his handling of Italy and Prussia. He sides with Italy at first during their unification movement and then backs out. And then during Prussia, he's like basically against them the entire time, mostly due to this classic German-Franco rivalry that's been running around Europe for quite some time. He has constitutions rewritten, his power is going to be limited post-1860, and democracy with universal male suffrage is running head-on with chaotic times. 1860 and later Europe is going to be very chaotic. We're talking 1860 all the way up until 1914, very chaotic. Things are going to get tense, and it's going to basically lead to the First World War, right? So things are getting real, real dicey. And of course, what happens when you have universal male suffrage and you have a figurehead like an emperor, right, in charge of the French Second Empire during this era? people tend to turn and blame this figure, right? And much like many politicians, Napoleon wanted to be that guy that kept everybody happy. He tried too hard to keep everybody happy, and people are going to start turning on him, right? So, like, now the biggest thing about it is, like we said, Second Empire, we break it into those two chunks, right? 1852 to 1860, and then 1860 to 1871, when it basically comes to an end again, right? So now going forward, though, we are now talking about those chaotic times, right? We're going to talk about those chaotic things that led a lot of people to actually turning their back on Napoleon III, right? The biggest part of this is going to be due to nationalistic movements in Italy. So that's right, Annabella, we're getting to that point that you're going to get real excited about. We're going to see Italy become a flipping country, right? Like, Italy is about to become a unified, contiguous state. A nation state, a place that Italians can call their home universally, rather than actually referring to themselves by region or city, okay? So now, looking at Italian history up to this point, you have to understand that it goes in two phases, right? The first one was when Italy was unified under a common leadership, and that was during the Roman Empire period, which is going to actually end around 476 AD, as we already know. Then you're going to go into the medieval era all the way up to 1861. And from the medieval era all the way up to 1861, Italy was chunked up and chopped up into multiple different areas and multiple different constituent areas that were controlled by different European powers as well as also controlled by some Italian leaders, right? So when we're looking, for example, at over on this map, we got to kind of ask ourselves is who owns what, right? So getting into it right around 1815, following the Congress of Vienna, you've got Tuscany and the Piedmont, Sardinia over here being controlled by an Italian figure, and we'll get to that here in a minute. But then this entire area is controlled by Austria. The Papal States right here in the middle is controlled completely by the Catholic Church and the Pope. That is very important to understand. The Papal States are controlled by the Catholic Church and the Pope. And then the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies down here is controlled by a cadet Bourbon branch that actually originally started off in the Spanish monarchy, right? So you've got basically Spain's weird second cousins kind of own like this entire area down here called the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies, right? So now, the big thing about it, though, is going into it, is that is what Italy has been since the medieval period, is like chunked up and chopped up into different municipalities and different sovereign states, right? So going forward, though, after the Congress of Vienna, which of course is going to happen in multiple phases, 1814, 1815, you're going to see a lot of different lead up happening to nationalism exploding throughout Italy, right? Never forget that in like Two Sicilies example. Remember in 1820, after the original Congress of Vienna, right? The Kingdom of the Two Sicilies tried to revolt and have an autonomous government that included a democratically elected branch and also a constitution. And how did Metternich deal with that? Crushed it, right? Like, so literally just sent an entire, like, Austrian army in to crush any liberal constitution rising up, right? So the thing about it is ever since 1820 and the crushing of that revolution, there had been a lot of talk going around through the different regions of Italy. These early figures are going to show up, starting to be like, should we call ourselves Florentines? Should we call ourselves Neapolitans? Should we call ourselves Pisans? Should we call ourselves these different areas we're from? Or should we call ourselves Italians, right? So, like, you have to understand that following the Congress of Vienna, there was still an issue that ran around Italy. Italians didn't see themselves as a unified group, right? They saw themselves based out of the region that they lived in, and those regions had fierce rivalries with one another. All the way back to the Renaissance era, we know very well that Milan and Venice and Florence did not like each other. Literally, Michelangelo's David is a political statement against Rome by Florence, right? So you have to understand that regionally speaking, they didn't really get along, right? But some of these early figures are going to come along to try and change that. Guys like Giuseppe Mazzini, right? Giuseppe Mazzini is going to be one of the very first people that starts this movement called Young Italy, right? So Young Italy is going to be a very important movement that he starts, where he preaches the concept of creating a liberal democratic republic that has no king or monarch, that has universal male suffrage, that is ruled completely by the people to create a unified Italian state. Oh, like that sounds beautiful, does it not? That is the idea of creating a new government based on Italy's culture, right? Giuseppe Mazzini is praised for this by many liberals. And he is a revolutionary of 1848. This guy literally led something called the First War of Italian Independence. against the Pope and several other European powers, right? So, like, Giuseppe Mazzini, of course, ends up exiled into France, and he has to try and run young Italy from there. He also has this buddy that he works with named Giuseppe Garibaldi, and we'll bring him back up in a little bit. But Giuseppe Mazzini kind of started this whole snowball rolling down the hill, and now it's gaining speed, right? The idea of a unified Italy. Now, then you got people like Vincenzo Gioberti, who is a priest, all right? And he preached, get it? Like, he preached and he preached this idea. Now, so it's a good joke. Leave me alone. Now, the idea, though, is that he's going to preach a federation of states that are controlled by a progressive pope. So Vincenzo Gioberti believed that the pope should be the ruler of an Italian contiguous state. It didn't really go that way, but other people had that same idea. Like, Napoleon III wanted the same thing. He was like, oh, the pope should be in charge because Catholicism, blah. I'm not saying that Catholicism is bad, but I'm just saying, like, you know, keep your church and your state a little bit separate, right? Even Elizabeth knew that. Now, like, so the big thing about it, though, is others are going to preach the idea of an autocratic kingdom under the lead of Sardinia, Piedmont, because they have their own model and they're doing really good, right? So, like, the kingdom of Sardinia, Piedmont is very, very important to understand because they have a king and they are very progressive. And they're making a lot of money under that king, right? And the thing about it is the current king underneath that idea is growing a lot in power, and a lot of people are starting to drift towards that idea. Because a lot of people felt that Mazzini's ideas were too idealistic, right? Because Mazzini literally started the revolution of 1848 in Italy against the Pope and both against the ruling authorities of other, like, the different Italian sovereign states. And then what's going to happen is, of course, he gets run out by Austrian forces, and he ends up exiled into France. Now, Sardinia, though, kept its liberal constitution and was lucky enough to keep its monarch, right? And that guy's name is Victor Emmanuel II. Now, he's in a long line of other guys. There's a Victor Emmanuel I and several other ones, but we're not worried about those guys. Down in the description below, there is a link to a course, like, to a video on the unification of Italy if you're looking for something else to watch, right? Now, the thing about it is, though, is that they talk a lot about the monarchs that lead up to Victor Emmanuel and a lot of the chaotic stuff going basically from post-Congress of Vienna all the way up until Italian unification in 1861. Now, giving you a little heads up, for the AP test, they don't really want you to know all that stuff. They just want you to know the unification phase, which is going from 1848 to 1861. So we're covering a very small chunk of time, only about like 12 years, right? Or 13 years. I can't do math. Now, the big thing about it, though, is Victor Emmanuel II, the king of Piedmont, Sardinia, that area, right? Let's bag it up. The king, oh, come on. We're going to do that? Sorry about that. Technical difficulties, right? I ended up at the very beginning of that prezi. You had to go back all the way through it. But Victor Emmanuel II is the king of Piedmont, Sardinia. This two peach-colored states right here. Oh, and fun fact, that's Corsica right there. And Elba is located right there. So, like, Elba, the first place that Napoleon was exiled to, of course. Now, Corsica, though, is located right there. Sardinia, Piedmont, was a state that was under the rulership of the monarchy under Victor Emmanuel II, right? Now, Victor Emmanuel II is going to be the one that creates a liberal constitution. And in his liberal constitution, he is going to try and set up the model for the new Italy by starting with Piedmont, Sardinia, and trying to lead unification in the north, right? And when he does this, he brings on a brilliant statesman who is elected as his prime minister. And that brilliant statement is Count Camillo Benso di Cavour, or Count Cavour for short, right? So now Count Cavour and Victor Emmanuel II are going to be the ones that basically create the political nationalist setup for the unification of Italy. Because the unification of Italy happens in two phases, a northern phase and a southern phase, right? And we'll talk about that here in a minute. And you can probably write that down in your notes, the northern phase and the southern phase. The northern phase is going to be led by Victor Emmanuel II and Count Cavour, right? They're going to come together and they're going to try to unite the state of Italy together under one roof, under one umbrella, right? So now the nationalism in Italy movement is going to keep rolling forward, basically under Count Cavour, though, right? Victor Emmanuel II was the autocrat in the background, right? He is the limited monarch now under their new constitution that is going to just basically be signing off on a lot of things, right? Not much unlike the legislative branch that Napoleon III has set up in France, right? The Napoleonic, like the Second Empire legislative branch, was another rubber stamp assembly, and Napoleon III would be like, pass this, and then be like, okay. Just like in this kind of sense, Cavour is going to say to Victor Emmanuel, pass this. And he's going to say, okay. And he's just going to rubber stamp it and move some stuff through, right? Cal Kovar, though, just to give you some background, besides the fact that he needs to buy a new, like, blazer. Come on, man. Like, it looks like you've been wearing that thing since third grade. Now, like, so the big thing about it, though, is Cal Kovar is born into the nobility. Let's not act like he's some kind of middle-class liberal that started at the bottom and then now he's here, right? So, like, now, he is actually born into the nobility, created a very successful business. And he's also very, very wealthy, right? So he actually understands how post-industrial economics work, and he understands how to manipulate them into his favor, right? Now, going forward, his original ideas were simple. He had no desire to unite the entirety of Italy because he knew the biggest roadblock he would run into is the Papal States, right? And if you make the Papal States mad, if you make the Pope mad, even though it's a pretty liberal Pope right now, the Pope's name is Pius IX, right? So, like, even if you make him mad, you're still going to bring the rest of all the Catholic countries down on top of you, right? So his original idea is, like, look, just the northern area. Let's get Florence and Siena and Pisa and Venice. Everybody wants Venice because it's a trade hub, right? And they wanted to take Milan and unify it with this area called Lombardy. And Lombardy is, like, right next door, right? So it goes Sardinia, Lombardy, and then Venice over on the eastern side. Now, the big one that he wanted out of all of them was Venice, right? And he wanted to leave the Papal States in southern Italy to their own vices. Why? Because the Catholic Church did not want a unified Italy, Italian country. The Catholic Church knew that if they actually went to a unified Italy structure, then there's a chance that the government of this new kingdom and territory could isolate the Catholic Church and impose their governmental will upon them, right? So that's a whole other shebang, and all this other crazy stuff is going on. But in the long run, though, what's going to happen is Count Cavour is going to use his noble ideas, his money that he made from, like, railroads as well, like, from different, like, crop experimentation and stuff, and he's going to convince Victor Emmanuel to create a progressive liberal state with a new constitution that grants civil liberties to people, right? Like freedom of speech and freedom of press and an uncensored press at that. He creates railroads and infrastructure all over Piedmont, Sardinia, and he wants to reduce the role of the church in political things in northern Italy, right? This begins to curry a lot of favor for Victor Emmanuel II, and the people begin to really enjoy Count Cavour's ideas as well as Victor Emmanuel's. And the big thing about it is this enjoyment is going to spread to other areas in northern Italy outside of Piedmont, Sardinia. People like in the Lombardy area are going to be wanting to be a part of Piedmont, Sardinia because it seems like they're progressing forward and that there's a lot of money to be made there and that they have a progressive monarch that wants to give them a lot of rights, right? So the thing about it is these reforms caught the biggest eyes, though, of Napoleon III, right? Napoleon III saw what was going on in northern Italy under Cavour, and he was like, wait, maybe I have a possible ally here, right? And so what's going to happen is Napoleon III and Cavour are going to form an alliance, right? They create an alliance between Piedmont, Sardinia, and France, right? So the big thing about it, though, is why is this advantageous for both sides? What's the point? Who cares, right? Why would you ever want to do this? Here's the big reason why, all right? A lot of it has to do with Austria, right? So France, at this point, doesn't necessarily hate Austria. Not the world's biggest fans of them, but they don't necessarily want to make them mad either, right? Because there's a delicate situation that's about to break out all over Europe, right? And that actually is going to be called the Crimean War, right? So what's going to happen, we'll talk about this a little bit later on, it was all provoked mainly because of Christian sites and Ottomans and that they controlled them and the Russians are going to try and run in there and take them, but in reality, the Russians just wanted Black Sea trade routes so they could actually rival the British. And so what's going to happen in the Crimean War, though, is the rest of Europe is going to collectively basically stand up, get together, and go fight Russia, right? So, like, Russia, who's going to be crushed in the Crimean War after 3 long years and a lot of death, are going to see the crushing at the hands of people like France and Sardinia, Piedmont, right? So, like, what ends up happening in the long run is the Sardinians, under the command of Count Cavour and Napoleon III, are going to go over in the Crimean War and help them beat the Russians, right? Now, the thing about it is, Sardinia wants something in return for their services, right? So they helped out Napoleon III by going and helping actually fight the Russians, having a well-trained military, and impressing actually like Napoleonic like strategies upon the Italian troops, which Cavour saw as a plus. Now, what Cavour wanted in return, though, was France's help to actually drive Austria out of northern Italy, right? Like, basically, Cavour was like Napoleon III, look, you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours, right? You, once this war with Russia is done, you're going to send a military contingent into northern Italy, and we're going to oust Austria out of the Lombardy region, and most importantly, out of Venice, right? And France actually holds up their end of the deal. The Sardinians fight in the Crimean War, and then the second war for Italian independence starts in 1859. And the French, along with the Sardinians, with their very, very nice, pretty new flag that can be seen right here. Yeah, look familiar? That's going to be kind of the image, the tricolor flag of the Italian unification movement. Sardinia used it as their national flag, right? They're going to start pushing the Austrians out of northern Italy following the Crimean War. And this is the Crimean War, and the Crimean War is going to be a really big event. That's why I have it in red. France and Sardinia drove the Austrians out of Lombardy, and there was massive victory going on, and everybody was feeling themselves, and they were like, we're going to do this thing. But then something important happens, and you need to highlight this and star this and make it underlined and stuff like that, because it's not going to go the way Cavour wanted it to, right? They were then on their way to drive them out of Venice. But weirdly, though, out of nowhere, France abandoned the cause, right? Out of fear of making the Austrians mad. Not the Austrians mad, excuse me. Out of fear of making French Catholics mad, right? So, like, they were getting too close to the Papal States, right? Some of these places called the United Central Provinces of Italy were trying to look at Sardinia and be like, maybe this Italian unification idea is good, which would have led to the loss of land by the Pope. So basically, Napoleon III went, psych, just kidding, I'm out, I'm leaving. And so before they ever had a chance to take over Venice, the French actually pulled out. Now, the Pope, again, is against the idea of this autocratic northern Italy, so Sardinia only got Lombardy, but not Venice or Tuscany, right? And so Cavour is furious with this because they only now had this area and they're going to end up getting this a little bit later, right? So what ends up going down is they always wanted Venice more than anything else, and now that the French have just kind of bailed out on them, Cavour is like, really? Real mature. And out of absolute rage, Cavour and Emmanuel did not get to conquer the like northern Italian region of Venice, which forced peace with Austria. Cavour is going to resign his position of prime minister out of fury and rage, right? So they only got Lombardy, and that was it. And they're really, really mad and upset about that, right? But here's the beautiful thing. Sardinian forces. Maria, can you let them out, please? All right, so Sardinian forces, under the new flag of this beautiful tricolor idea of, like, liberating, like, Italy and bringing them underneath one rulership, are going to be very beautifully inspired by the northern Italians, right? These united provinces of southern Italy inspired the middle areas of Florence and Parma to rise up and overthrow their governments and join up with Sardinia. So now, because of this like whole idea of like driving them out of Lombardy, the northern half of Italy is united, right? And this led to actually the Pope losing some land, right? And Napoleon was the third was like, look, if you don't take any more, it'll probably be fine. But danger, danger, right? So like, because the big thing about it is there's some stuff going on in the south of Italy, right? Now, one, Cavour and Victor Emmanuel have successfully made the Pope pretty angry because they took away a chunk of his land, right? So the thing you need to look at is that this next map is going to be very, very important, okay? So looking at this area right here, that's Sardinia Piedmont, right? They took over this whole area in 1859. These ones join up in 1860, and then look at this. 1860. Yeah, that, see that little chunk right there, the Papal States that was originally actually owned by the Pope? That joined with Florence and then went into Sardinia. So by the end of 1860, like Sardinia and like Piedmont under Victor Emmanuel and Cavour control this, 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 and this part right here. But they didn't have the Papal States, and they also didn't have the southern part, right? So the thing about it is, as this arrow continues to go forward, you're getting dangerously close to Rome. So basically, Count Cavour is going to throw his hands up and be like, we're not going to go any further. But what's going down is that they had to give Nice and Savoy to France to prevent Napoleon from intervening on the Pope's side, right? The Pope calls to the French and says, help us get our territory back. Napoleon III's like, I'm good because I just got two new provinces, right? So at the Treaty of Turin, which is right here and here in these two areas, those went to France, right? To try and prevent Napoleon from intervening inside of any kind of engagement that could possibly happen with the Pope. Because remember, the Pope doesn't have his own army. He has to hire mercenaries all the time. So without the French, he doesn't really have anything at all. Now what's going to end up going down, though, is we got to get this part, right? So, like, the southern Italian region is going to have an interesting little dynamic, and this is the southern phase of Italian unification, right? So here comes the real hero of this entire thing, Giuseppe Garibaldi, right? Giuseppe Garibaldi is the guerrilla warfare, beautiful, romantic hero that looks exactly like Jeff Daniels from Dumb and Dumber with a beard. But we're not going to get into that right now. He enters in as the beautiful hero that will show up and unite the southern Italian provinces, not under the ideas of a ruling monarch, but under the ideas of a republic, right? So as you can see right here, Garibaldi's a pretty famous guy. This right here is money from Uruguay, right? There are so many Italian immigrants that have gone to Uruguay by this point, and they have heard of like Garibaldi's movements, and Garibaldi even came all the way over to Uruguay and helped them in their liberation movement. He has become famous as a freedom fighter. Here is Cavour right here on the Uruguayan money. There is Garibaldi right there. So Garibaldi is this famous figure that has been known as the romantic hero of the Italians. He believes in direct intervention, military action, and young men going off to fight against autocrats that do not belong in Italian lands, right? He actually also was heavily on the side of Giuseppe Manzini, right? Giuseppe Manzini and the Young Italian Movement. So he lived for a certain amount of time in two different areas. One in France, and then two later on in this place called San Marino, which is now technically not a part of the Italian state, because basically he made an agreement with them, along with Cavour, that San Marino would remain autonomous from any Italian state later on. And to this day, they're still technically their own country. Now, the big thing about it that ends up happening, though, is he recruits a force of 1,000 young men. And he takes time to capitalize, right? In 1860, after the Treaty of Turin, which is the thing that gave Nice and Savoy to France to prevent them from interfering in the Northern Italian unification, Garibaldi recruited 1,000 young men. Patriots known as red shirts for the beautiful bright red shirts that they wore that actually was reflected in the Italian tricolor, and they were actually going to go down and take advantage of revolts that were already happening in Sicily against these like oligarchical and autocratic nobles that actually controlled all the land in Sicily, right? So how did Victor Emmanuel feel about this? He's a little nervous, right? He's nervous, he's apprehensive, he doesn't know really what's going on, but he does know that he has to do one thing, and he has to prevent Garibaldi from showing up and actually basically taking over the Pope, because if he does that, then you're going to bring the fury of the rest of Catholic Europe down upon you, right? So the big thing about it, though, is the Sicilian peasants were already in revolt. And so here comes Garibaldi with his red shirt warriors. They show up, they lead these violent uprisings against these landlords, and they have a lot of early success. And one big one known as the Battle of Palermo they won, and this is actually showing right here Garibaldi landing on the shores of Sicily with his red shirt warriors that are showing up to unify the entire area of Sicily underneath the new ideas of a united Italian kingdom, right? So now going forward, Garibaldi used guerrilla tactics to outwit larger and stronger military forces that he actually faced. And also, interestingly enough, the military forces are going to be backed up by the Austrians. The Austrians sent a very heavy military contingent to try and prevent them from taking over the Spanish cadet branch of the Bourbons, right? Now, the thing about it is that Austrians didn't adopt the merit system that Napoleon used. So they actually had bad military leaders that were only there due to the fact that they were born from noble privilege, right? So it was about like who their mom and dad knew. It wasn't about how like their military successes. Garibaldi, on the other hand, used guerrilla tactics against their poor leader, like their poorly led armies, and ended up outwitting them and using like against much stronger forces. Garibaldi was then declared dictator of the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies in the name of Victor Emmanuel II. But here's the problem. He's right next to the Papal States, right? He took over that entire southern area of Italy. He gets dangerously close to the Papal States. And quickly, to prevent the Pope from calling on Swiss mercenaries and the French and the Austrians as well, Cavour ran a bunch of people down to, like, basically Rome and stacked them around Rome. We were like, don't worry, Pope. We'll protect you from these Italian rebels. And so basically they went to intercept, not attack Garibaldi, because they knew if they actually, like, he got there, it would bring down the full fury of the Catholic, or the Catholic French, right? So here's what ends up happening, though. At one of the most majestic scenes ever, what ends up going down, it's instead of fighting Victor Emmanuel II, which Garibaldi did not want to be the king of Italy, he relented and gave it to him anyway. Why? Why did he do this? Why did Garibaldi, a romantic Republican who wants nothing but liberal constitutions and legislative branches, give the conquered territories of that he took over in southern Italy to this man, a constitutional monarch, that he doesn't necessarily believe in his government ideas? Why would he do this? because it's not about being romantic anymore. Romanticism is failing again, okay? Just like how romanticism was a reaction to the failed movement of the Enlightenment, romanticism is demonstrating the fact that just like Giuseppe Mazzini's ideas of a liberal democratic republic and the revolutions of 1848 and rah, 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 and all those romantic ideas, it's not realistic, right? So this right here, Garibaldi giving the lands he took over to Victor Emmanuel II to create the unified Kingdom of Italy, was a part of this thing that being adopted at the time called Realpolitik, right? So spelt real, R-E-A-L, space, P-O-L-I-T-I-E-K. Realpolitik is realistic politics, or realism in politics. Garibaldi gave these conquered lands to Victor Emmanuel II because he knew for a fact if he held on to them, you're just going to end up with two separate Italies again. By instead giving them to a limited monarch who at least has supported civil liberties, you will at least that way have the glory that is a unified Italy, right? And that is exactly what ended up happening, right? So Garibaldi had no desire to lead, so he turned those conquered territories over to Victor Emmanuel II and Sardinia. He gave them that land because his dream was unified Italy. Not necessarily in Italy under his ideas, but just a unified Italian state, right? Which is a beautiful thing when you think about it. And this is the last slide. This is all the stuff from the unification of Italy. Italy is going to be united into a kingdom in 1860, and then by 1861, it is going to be known as modern-day Italy, okay? And then also 1870, by then, it's going to be the Italy you know now, right? But now, more on that later, but we'll talk about that. Like, Austria will lose Venice and actually finally give that up in 1866. And then by 1870, you're going to see basically the Papal States relent and give away all their land in Rome, and the capital will be moved to Rome, and then basically, like, the Vatican will just be this little independent municipality. Now, the thing about it is Italy would be a parliamentary monarch. Neither radical and neither nor completely democratic, right? Because they are going to actually stay under Victor Emmanuel's family, and they are also going to keep passing that down through hereditary, but they're also going to have a parliament that's going to be located in Rome, okay? Now, problems are not going to be completely solved because there were still a lot of hectic things that Italy had to deal with, right? For example, the thing about it is North Italy was very, very industrious and very quick to progress, whereas Southern Italy was very, very slow and agrarian, right? You're going to see a lot of anarchist rebellions break out in Italy in the 1900s. And another big thing is massive Italian immigration, mostly from Southern Italy and Sicily. And a lot of those Italian immigrants are going to head towards the United States, right? And only about 0.5 million people could vote out of the 22 million Italian citizens that were there. But that is it. That is the unification of Italy in general. Make sure you get your key figures out of that. We had Victor Emmanuel II, Napoleon III, Count Cavour, and Garibaldi. And we'll talk about the progression of things, and we'll work it out on a map whenever y'all get back from break, okay? But I hope y'all enjoy your Mardi Gras break. That's your one long flip. Enjoy yourselves. Y'all have a good one. And also, congratulations. We're ahead in content right now. So keep kicking butt, all right? I'll see y'all soon. Y'all have a good one.